Everyone thinks they're an expert on wheel fitment, but we're always surprised of how often people get it wrong. We're here with Eddie from Titan 7 to get a little bit more insight into how the pros do it. So Eddie, I just want to start off by getting an idea of the design process for one of your wheels. Let's start at the conceptual stage. How do you first start a design process, and what are the first kind of constraints that you start with?
Well, yeah, when it comes to actually designing a wheel, we have to first think about, like, what are our objectives, right? So you look at, like, any given market. Let's just take, for example, the Civic Type R, the FL5. And then we get together by committee and we talk about, like, what is there maybe something missing in the market, a certain type of design, or if there's something that hasn't been done in a while. So there's a lot of different approaches that you take. And once we, you know, pinpoint something, then we go about, you know, going back and forth in terms of coming up with rendering sketches. And then, and of course, you know, the really important part is, like, the setup, right? In terms of the size, the application, what are the available tires, brakes? So we have to kind of go through this, you know, step-by-step process of identifying, you know, the markers that we have to, check all the boxes, right? So are there any weight targets, performance targets? Are we going racing with it? There's so many things you have to think about, you know, it's, but having it done, you know, I've been doing wheels for about, you know, 25 years now. So it's like kind of just rattled off in my brain, you know? So there's conceptual. And once we get, you know, to the point where we have drawings, samples getting made, then we have to actually do the analysis, right? So there's digital analysis, there's FEA analysis, right? And if it passes that and we prove that the structure is kind of worthy of actually making a sample and to go to testing, then we go into lab testing, track testing, and so forth.
I just want to back up a little bit. So when we're setting the specifications for, let's say, the FL5, and you're determining what diameter you're going to make the wheel, what width, what offset, what factors into that? Are you looking at the factory specification and making kind of educated changes to that? Are you going to always step up a size and diameter? You're going to go wider? Are you trying to keep the scrub radius the same? What goes into those decisions?
Right. So as an aftermarket wheel, you know, manufacturer, you know, typically, like, that our type of customer wants to go wider, bigger, you know, have some more, you know, dynamic look to it. Right. So we take that into consideration. But we also have to also talk about, you know, since we're a performance wheel company, we have to make sure that your lap times are better, you know, those type of, and then also the safety factors. Right. So, yeah. So, you know, everything comes into play. So making sure that we clear aftermarket brakes, you know, what are the popular suspensions? You know, are we, you know, as opposed to, like, running a stock suspension versus a coilover, right? So the tolerances and the spacing changes, right? So we want to make sure that when you slap on a set of our wheels that it fits right, it works very well with the popular tire sizes that the consumer wants to run with, right? Clears all the appropriate big brake kits, right? And then, of course, it has to look good. You know, wheels, no matter what you do, like, if you have, like, the best performing wheel out there, but it looks like crap, no one's going to buy it, right? So we have to also take that in consideration, that it's a fashion business as well. So
that makes a lot of sense. Backing up a little bit to the performance metrics that you talked about, obviously, when it comes to wheels, strength, weight, stiffness are three things that kind of all go hand in hand with the design. How do you determine meeting a stiffness goal or a weight goal? What's more important?
Well, they're all equally important, right? So I think, you know, the misnomer is that everyone just thinks about weight, right? If you have a wheel that's too light, I mean, lighter is better for sure, right? You know, removing unsprung weight is the most efficient way of improving performance on the car. But then you have camber stiffness, right? You have to make sure that when you're going through a corner, we're at World Time Attack, you know, if your wheel deflects multiple degrees, even though it's light, you know, you kind of go backwards. Right, so we have to make sure within the design and within the manufacturing process that you're going to have a wheel that doesn't deflect a whole lot. It's also very safe. And so in our case, we use a completely forged wheel, right? So you have that inherent, you know, improved properties, you know, of the aluminum that we introduced by using forging, right?
So the actual forging process itself, it gives you that strength in the core structure of the wheel that allows you more flexibility in the design process?
Yeah, so we have, within the forging, you know, we have our basic blanks, right? So it's called, you know, when we add all of that force, right, in our case, 10,000 to 12,000 tons of force, right? So it's extremely high. And then it's what we call, like, the grain flow, right? So within the tool, you see, like, the microstructure of the wheel getting really organized, right? And that provides the solid foundation on how design is going to be machined out, right? So then within that, you have strength, weight, all of that built in, and then everything's proven through digital and lab testing. So
I just want to also come back to what you talked about with camber stiffness and the effect of that. So essentially, the less stiff a wheel is with that camber compliance, if you're losing, you know, a degree of camber for pulling 1G in a corner, that's 1 degree more negative camber you need to run static?
Yeah, so if you have a wheel that has a lot of deflection, right, you're going to have to build an extra camber, right? And so if you have extra camber built in, then your contact patch goes down, right? So our goal is so that you have to run the least amount of camber as possible so that you always have a full contact patch every time, every portion of the track.
Trying to minimize those compromises to straight line performance as well as cornering.
Right. So the suspension engineers, you know, they want, it's always better when you take out less variables, right? So the last thing you want to have to think about is the wheel that's always bending, you know, mid corner. You want to let the tire and the suspension do the work. And those are the things that you want to figure out, you know, rather than the wheel. So.
Cool. And the other aspect I wanted to touch on with the weight of the wheel, we talked about unsprung weight. I think that's a commonly understood thing, but the actual rotating inertia of the wheel, what effect does that have?
Oh, it's huge. So you have, you know, improvements in just general driving dynamics, acceleration, braking, less strain on the drivetrain. You know, if we want to get into the even better MPG, right, or MP, yeah. Liters, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, sorry. But yeah, so yeah, every, you know, you of course you want to go as light as possible, but you know, we have to stay within the given safety constraints as well. Yeah.
In terms of the actual design process and determining, you know, if you're going with a 10 spoke or something like this to a 5 spoke, is there any advantage to one fundamental design over the other?
Yeah, so some designs are inherently more challenging in terms of like strength and weight properties. So far, you know, within our testing, like a split 5 is probably the best in terms of having a really good weight lightness to strength ratio. 10 spoke is also very good. 5 spoke is probably the least, you know, but it looks the best maybe to some people. So we have to make sure that we put everything out. But the advantage that we have is that our core of having a forged wheel, it gives us that advantage of being able to put out whatever design, but it's going to be within the realm of being some of the lightest, strongest, best wheels that you can use.
Yeah. What are some of the other features on the wheels? I see the back pads of them are hollowed out, things like that. Is that something you're also just doing with the spokes as well to reduce weight?
Yeah, so we kind of take a complete approach when it comes to designing our wheels. So, you know, going back to strength, right? So we're probably the first to come out with a reinforced inner rim flange. And so we took that design off of rally wheels because, and going back to like, you know, like your track setup, right? You have wheels that are running a little bit of camber, right? So the part of the wheel that's going to get impacted the most is actually this inner rim flange, especially when you hit like, you know, FIA curbs or whatnot. And so we want to make sure that this part is super strong, right? But that adds weight. And so we have to really take a look at the rest of the structure to make sure, you know, we machine wherever we can without sacrificing strength, but also making sure that we have a good light wheel.
Yeah. And the final feature I wanted to mention here, I see, looks like most of the wheels you have bead knurling. What purpose does that serve?
So it provides a little bit more traction. So, you know, oftentimes you see a lot of track cars, they'll have like a dot lined up, right? They want to see if there's any tire creep. Right. So back in the days, you know, people would use adhesives or like spray, like some type of like a media, just so that it has like a sandpaper grit, you know, kind of effect. So with us, you know, we have this gear cut knurled bead seat, which is a little bit cleaner, it's a more elegant, you know, solution to that. And yeah, just make sure that, you know, you minimize that tire creep as much as possible.
What is the actual result of that tire creep?
So with tire creep, yeah, well, obviously, if it's creeping a lot, then you're losing traction, right? So you're wasting precious seconds or whatnot, right? And then also, like, it can be as bad as if it's creeping a lot, then you can have harmonics issues. You know, back in the days with old F1 cars, they had a lot of blowouts or whatnot because of that type of situation. So, you know, everything you can do just to make sure everything's in its place, right, is always better.
Awesome. I think that gives some good insight into the design process and the considerations behind performance wheels and designing them for vehicles as well. If people want to follow along with what you're doing, see your products, where are they best to do so?
www.titan-7.com, and our distributor in Australia is JDM Yard.
Awesome. Thanks for your time.
All right, Connor. Thank you very much.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.